Take a pinch of Grimm's fairy tale with all the gruel, a soupçon of classic 18th century literature by philosopher Voltaire, and use this as the template for a film by notorious shockumentary filmmakers Gualtiero Jacopetti and Franco Prosperi. And what do you get? Today's offering of Look, Look and Look Again, of course. Let's go, Mondo! To look at our film on today's programme, Mondo Candido, we need to look at the men behind the lens who pioneered a fascinating but equally disturbing genre of films known as Mondo movies, Mondo being Italian for world. These films, also known as shockumentaries, may have their roots as far back as 1903 with Thomas Edison's electrocution of an elephant, featuring the frazzling demise of Topsy, an elephant on Coney Island who, due to Topsy's uncontrollable and violent nature, more than likely triggered by the barbarity of the keeper no doubt, was targeted for euthanasia by the owners and the keepers. To make a fast buck, the crowds were going to be charged to see this poor creature be hung, but the American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals stepped in, and the method settled for was electrocution.
Nearly the elephant packed her trunk and said goodbye to the circus. Off she went with a trumpety trump, 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 trump.
This is one of several actuality films by the Edison Manufacturing Company, which were filmed on Coney Island from about 1897 onwards. Electrocuting an Elephant was released on January the 17th, 1903, 13 days after poor Topsy's death, and could be seen in Edison's coin-operated kinetoscope. It's ironic that the first example of films of this kind feature what some would consider a most repellent act of animal cruelty, which in Mondo film and shockumentary feature heavily to hammer home the message of how cruel man is to the natural world around him. But as we're in Mondo territory, the more sensational, exploitational it can be, the better for these type of films. Although movies dabbled in Mondo-esque, such examples as Caramoja in 1954 and The Mating Urge, for example, and pseudo-educational films in the 1930s, looking at mainly African tribes, a good excuse to show nudity and other forbidden fruit, without incurring the wrath of the censors, the first breed of less cozy jungle movies were films such as 1950's Savage Africa, Voodoo Village also in 1958, where we see in these films more emphasis on nudity and bloodletting. 1960 saw the Italian film World by Night being released, which features burlesque and bizarre variety stage acts from around the world. It was written by Gualtiero Jacopetti and became a hit. Therefore, as inspiration, Jacopetti wondered if he could match the popularity of the film, but with something even more salacious. In 1962, that one movie alone kickstarted this taboo genre, confronting us with images we would try to avoid, wrapped up in exploitational cellophane, and it spurned a slew of imitations, as well as influencing how the news was reported going forward, and even, on hindsight, moulding the plague of reality television that cheaply saturates the channels to bored modern-day audiences. The movie in question was Mondo Carne.
Mondo Cane. People all over the world are talking about Mondo Cane. For Mondo Cane has more in it to talk about than any picture ever before seen. Mondo Cane is a spectacle as big as the eye can see. This intimate as the pleasures of motherhood. Mondo Cane is a picturization of the beautiful, the unusual, and the laughable, and the unique. Mondo Cane shows you the worst of man's bloodlust. And the most daring of his foolhardy braveries. Mondo Cane will be the most talked about picture in years. You will know the full power of the motion picture screen when you see the wholly unbelievable, but wholly true, Mondo Cane.
Roughly translated, it means it's a dog's life, and this was the collaboration of Gualtiero Jacopetti, who was a journalist, who leapt from publications to newsreels, and then on to filmmaking around the globe, and also Franco Prosperi, who was in fact a one-time assistant director to Mario Bava. The combination of both skilled and dedicated filmmakers churned out some truly grueling movies focusing mainly on the cruelty of mankind, the backbone of Mondo film. But despite the unsavory content, Jacopetti and Prosperi left a legacy and a definitive benchmark influencing the documentary format thereafter. Mondo Cane was the granddaddy of this format. The film was immensely popular in Europe upon its release. In the UK, the film, as you probably would gather, was rejected outright due to its graphicness, especially concerning our furry friends. However, this was the first time a documentary focused on death and the ways cultures address the taboo subject matter, a sort of cinematic memento mori, examining in epic proportion the culture of life and death, sex and religion, and the anguish of man and beast. Mondo Cane also features a beautiful soundtrack by Riz Ortolani and Nino Oliverio. And as Ortolani achieved with Cannibal Holocaust, contrasts shocking visceral vision with some of the most hauntingly exquisite music ever composed. Ortolani would go on to score nearly all of Prosperi and Jacopetti's features going forward. Mondo Cane was so popular, stunning the cinema-goer and critic alike, as well as revolutionising the documentary format, even sporting an Academy Award nominee for its theme, More. Prosperi and Jacopetti followed it up naturally with Mondo Cane Numero Due, also known as Mondo Pazzo, and as the poster screamed out, it's sick, sick time again, featuring another heady brew of contrasts from around the globe.
The shock heard round the world. Made by the men who made Mondo Cane, Mondo Pazzo is more of the same. It starts where Mondo Cane left off. Surmounting it in its indescribable beauty, surpassing it in the shocking and the bizarre. An awesome and astonishing panorama of human behavior. Mondo Pazzo is packed with electrifying realism and relentless power.
Set my heart to music. It will make the sweetest song. And the voice. understand. I love you. You fill my heart with music and my arms with longing too.
If you see only one motion picture this year, it must be Mondo Pazzo. For Mondo Pazzo is the picture of the year. Only the makers of Mondo Cane could produce a greater motion picture, a more shocking motion picture. This is Mondo Pazzo, Mondo Pazzo, Mondo Pazzo.
Vivisection, transvesticism, alligator hunting, and a fake but haunting image of a monk setting himself on fire, courtesy of special effects maestro Carlo Rimbaldi, who you know is a creator of E.T. Whether the model of E.T. was based on the creator is debatable, although actress Helen Wirth gets my vote. Just as the first Mondo Cane movie, the second Mondo Pazzo proved very popular indeed and secured a third Mondo film from Jacopetti and Prosperi, which was Women of the World.
Do you remember Mondo Cane? It ran for 9 months. In 9 months, it was shown all over the world. For 9 months, it was praised, condemned, discussed, hated, and loved. In 9 months, 9 million people saw Mondo Cane, and 9 months ago, it achieved its first success. Then, after 9 months, the woman in the world was born. Here begins our little story, which will tell about the glory of the woman who possesses an attraction that distresses in a way so violent an entire regiment. To enforce emancipation, she will thus defend the nation, swearing faith, as you can tell, to the army of Israel. Notwithstanding all the strain, she will gladly endure the pain. In a search of beauty and grace, she lets people skin her face. Less drastic in another place, they slap muck upon the face. It has perfume, don't you doubt it, and the flies are wild about it. And the women in Japan have another type of plan. They increase a certain section with a once-a-month injection of a strange medicine that they call paraffin.
And this followed Mondo Pazzo, or Mondo Numero Due, in 1963, and was narrated by Peter Ustinov. And although Ustinov's narrative provides an air of sobriety to the visuals, it is contrasted by the exploitational excuse to show women of various shapes, sizes, and nationalities in states of undress. This courted controversy because a lawsuit was filed against the Italian and US distributors as it featured the crew wandering around the Hamburg Light District without permission to be filmed there, and it also, Women of the World pissed off the Israeli government, who okayed their female army to be filmed doing army exercises, but not showering afterwards. Allegedly, these scenes were asked to be excised from the print. It was in 1964, Prosperi and Jacopetti were aware of colonization ending in Africa. So Jacopetti traveled across Africa with a small film crew to film the transition. It is one of the most disturbing, fascinating, repellent, and absorbing cinematic documents to a country in utter turmoil, which became the film Africa Addio, or Farewell Africa. The strategy of colonialism ends, ushering in a changed continent of independent nationality. And it's here with Africa Addio that we see a complete transition and the blueprint for the more shockumentary orientated Mondo films that came after it. For here with Africa Addio, Prosperi and Jacopetti go straight for the jugular. There's no respite with regards to combining the quirky and the cutesy and the kooky with more graphic footage as the earlier Mondo film. And with Africa Addio, there is very little contrast. So, with this in mind, Jacopetti and Prosperi brings us a film about the Dark Continent and takes us to some very dark places. And with it reveals a continent littered with anarchy, and to view this extremity, we, as a viewer, need nerves of steel and the constitution of an ox. The film is a mass with dead bodies, poachers, assassins, and despots. Humans in this film are shot at point blank with pistols and shredded in a hail of machine gun bullets. Some are chopped up, hung, and trampled to death. Exotic fauna of rare beauty, like rhinos, zebras, hippos, giraffes, and elephants, are slaughtered wholesale. Unflinching and in some cases in the most cruelest ways imaginable. The hippo, after being speared numerous times, resembles in all the world like an animated pincushion in a sequence that lives long in the memory after the image has faded. Such is Mondo. Whilst filming Africa Addio, the directors nearly lost their lives, and during it, the filmmakers captured the jaw-dropping genocide of 20,000 Arabs, attributed to the Zanzibar Revolution of 1964.
Then, the next day,
to see thousands of people flee for their lives along the coastline, some running into the sea in sheer desperation as they try to escape their impending fate, and then filming the next day with the same shoreline littered with the corpses of the massacre that occurred, is very harrowing stuff indeed. Not to mention, of course, the aftermath of the Mau Mau uprising, which makes Africa Addio compelling but disturbing viewing. Another successful contrast in all of Jacopetti and Prosperi's films. The uncut Italian version of Africa Addio runs 138 minutes, but in an exploitational move, Jerry Gross's Cinemation distributors hacked 40 minutes of the more political footage and narrative, leaving the gruel only, to which the film was released in 1973 again as a truncated Africa Blood and Guts. I favour the full version, which is of course the definitive example of Prosperi and Jacopetti's work.
Dozens of Arabs have put to the wall. Someone has killed three mutineers, so now there must be a reprisal. But we're not welcome at the execution. They scream at us and threaten us with machine guns. When we stall to get some good shots, one of the soldiers loses his temper. One of us is cut by the flying glass, but there's no question of treatment. The mutineers jerk us out of our car and haul us to the wall. They're about to execute us when a rebel officer sees one of our passports and shouts, "Wait! These aren't whites. They're Italians."
From frying pan into the fire in terms of controversy saw Jacopetti and Prosperi leave the horrors of modern-day Dark Continent trauma to the past with Addio Zio Tom, also known as Goodbye Uncle Tom, where the two filmmakers travel back in time to the time of slavery and presents to us an unflinching, highly incendiary and shocking testament of how man's inhumanity to man was aimed at the black man and woman. Goodbye Uncle Tom was filmed in Haiti with Francis Papa Doc Duvalier giving permission for the locals being used in the role of the slaves and as extras. The film features a cast of hundreds and their naivety adds another layer of realism to the proceedings that unfold. The movie presents this bleak period of history in unflinching, bloody detail, and the production values are so high, it's almost like actually being there, as the film crew document life not only from the plantation owner's perspective, but from the slaves themselves, and some scenes are truly queasy. Such controversy followed its release that Italian authorities seized all prints of the movie after its premiere screening. Of the movie, the Italian authorities said that the film was contrary to common decency and ethical sentiments in frequent scenes of vulgar sex by its exasperated depiction of race hatred and by tragic and bloody killings that the race struggle engenders in this spectacle. The film was recut after this condemnation, but despite the editing, the film was a cinematic hot potato still, with many in fear that the film could incite a race war. Such was Goodbye Uncle Tom's power. Despite this, and as Africa Addio, it has to be seen to be believed, and it is thought-provoking, lush, spectacular and epic, which there again is in complete juxtaposition to it also being merciless, cruel, incendiary, and due to the subject matter, potentially one of the most explosively controversial movies of the 20th century, possibly even more so in 2020 than when it was first released in 1971. As Caligula showed us, the nearest thing to how Rome actually was, and you need explicitness to do it, so Goodbye Uncle Tom does exactly the self-same thing.
I beg your pardon, madam. We didn't mean to disturb, but may we...
Come, but of course, please.
But who are these gentlemen?
Europeans. To be precise, they're Italians. Journalists. They've come here to the South to conduct an inquest... Is that the proper expression? On slavery. Indeed, they seem to be quite sharp.
Uncle Tom leads very nicely into Mondo Candido. The same style of cinema verite is used here, except focusing on one time in history. With Candido, time and history gets blurred as the timelines and periods in history fuse together. Candido really is a smorgasbord of a huge combination of styles and nods to genres and directors. You can see in this film glimpses of Jodorowsky, Buñuel, Ken Russell, Fellini, and Borowczyk. Then amalgamates these directional styles with genres of Mondo-esque voyeurism, gallows humour, the rowdy, the whimsical, the lewd, and the poetic. Candido could also be considered as genre-defying, a kind of meta-film within a film. It is most certainly a movie that will never leave you shortchanged on the entertainment front. By 1975, when Mondo Candido was released, Jacopetti and Prosperi had shown us all they possibly could regarding Mondo, and whilst other Italian directors carried on the Mondo format, and as we venture into the late 1970s attempt to outgross one another, and Mondo gives way to the new kid on the block, the shockumentary, Jacopetti and Prosperi focus on another avenue to channel their skills. Predominantly, Mondo Candido is set in a faux medieval time, which echoes the popularity and influence of Pier Paolo Pasolini's movie The Decameron, The Canterbury Tales and The Arabian Nights, and its wave of imitations that came after it. all set in this antediluvian time period. Mondo Candido follows the adventures of Candido, an innocent, naive and construct youth who lives in a bubble. A nod to this can be seen in the bubbly beginning, and it's a bubble of wealth, riches and idealism, and Candido is on a natural high for the love he has for Cunegonda, daughter of a highly powerful baron. One bright, brilliant, sunshiny day, poor Candido is admiring his love on a swing, but she loses her grip, landing on Candido and providing him with a mouthful of Lady Garden. Candido's cunnilingual comfort concerning Cunegonda enrages Papa. Therefore, Candido is banished from his bubble into the wilderness, where he is catapulted into a Prussian army scenario, who end up battling modern-day militia with machine guns. He then rescues a black slave, Cocambo, from death by informing the Ku Klux Klan he owns him, and therefore solidifying an adventuring partnership, where they both travel to the torture chambers of the Inquisition and then surface on the streets of 1975 New York City, where they mix with Marilyn Monroe, Al Capone, and Abraham Lincoln. All the time, Candido pines for his darling Cunegonda, who is, and Candido isn't wise to this, having rumpy-pumpy with as many men as possible. This ultimately leads to blissfully ignorant Candido seeing the world for the shithole that it actually is. Candido moves within a rich visual tapestry of mise-en-scene after mise-en-scene, on the one hand an adventure of torn lovers trying to overcome obstacles, learning life's lessons and time travelling until they are reunited. And on the other hand, it works as an anti-war and enlightenment-challenging, anachronistic tour de force of a movie. Sumptuously filmed, proving that both directors were not just a one-trick pony, but highly talented directors in their own right, on par with some of the most revered. But alas, due to their controversial CV, is snobbily pushed aside by cineast elitists. Mondo Candido is based on the novella Candide, which was released way back in 1759. Ah, that golden age of frock-coated fuckery, and was quilled by philosopher François-Marie Arouet, known most famously, out of the 128 pen names he had, Voltaire. Candide, or Optimism, to give the full title of the novella, was a scandalous attack on Gottfried Leibniz. Leibniz was a major figure in a philosophical movement based purely on optimism, and where they rationalized that man is living in the best of all possible worlds. Voltaire believed this to be highly delusional, and so sends his character, Candide, on an odyssey to prove antithesis. Historically, shortly after Leibniz idealized this optimism, two major events rocked the theory. The first was the Seven Years' War of 1756, which threw Europe into utter turmoil, and the Lisbon earthquake of 1755, considered at the time to be two cataclysmic events resulting in numerous horrendous fatalities and suffering. Therefore, Voltaire presents this irony and challenges the silver lining credulity of Leibniz, blowing his argument completely out of the water. Something, in fact, that Jacopetti and Prosperi challenges all along with their Mondo films, so an ideal choice to make a movie about. The destruction of idealism by presenting the world as it is, in the cold, stark light of day, warts and all, and saying, yeah, some things are great, but there's also a lot of shit as well, delightfully popping the bubbles of those who are afraid of the truth and dodge the biggest, confrontation of all, that of reality. In Mondo Candido, at the very beginning, we also witness examples of art within art. The couple in the bubble at the beginning is obviously a representation of Hieronymus Bosch's The Garden of Earthly Delights. We also see Manet's Le Déjeuner sur l'Herbe and Atlas himself holding up the world or bubble, representing different facets of the film in the first 10 minutes. The magical, as in The Garden of Earthly Delights. The surreal and the candid, as in Le Déjeuner sur l'Herbe, and the mythological with Atlas, and also the fairy tale as we see Atlas's statue coming to life, all setting the tone for this quirky, offbeat movie. By 1975, people were also able now to affordably venture to these foreign, exotic, and mystical places. So the luster had worn unbearably thin with the Mondo film, specifically Prospero and Jacopetti's movies, as they indulged us just as much with the travelogue element as the sensational. With Mondo Candido, we are presented with another place or realm to explore, as though we've moved to the next level, that level of fantasy and borderline nonsensicality, and where, in a mythic landscape, like this film demonstrates to us, all time periods flow into one, and with certain sequences play out like a light fevered dream in the mind of a Monty Python fan. The lead of Candido is played by UK actor Christopher Brown. Now, when I first saw Candido, I recognised the actor from somewhere and puzzled my brains out where I'd seen him. But then it dawned on me, quite a while after, Brown played an Eternal called Mariner and a kind of tragic love figure for Tegan in the 1983 Doctor Who story, ironically called Enlightenment.
I hope you will forgive me for saying so, but I've never experienced a mind such as yours before.
You never will again.
I find it such a fascinating place, full of niches, life. It fascinates me. What are you doing?
Work it out for yourself.
You killed your thoughts. You're hiding them from me.
And that's the way it will remain until I find out exactly what's going on here.
This was Brown's second screen role, and he is suitably cast, displaying a gamut of believability in such a pivotal role, and justly portrays Voltaire's vision of the wet behind the ears youth who is thrust out of his comfort zone and, after much trial and tribulation, wakes up a bit like the woke generation nowadays. He is joined by Michelle Miller, who plays Cunegonda, a native New Yorker fresh from treading the boards, and along with Jack Herlin, an actor whose thespianism spans an impressive 6 decades, playing the part of Candido's syphilitic, spiritual and philosophical mentor, Dr. Pangloss, Mondo Candido isn't short of highly competent and credible actors who bring Voltaire's story further to life. Mondo Candido doesn't hold back either on its The World is Shit epistle, but demonstrates it with such visually stimulating folly that you can't help but kind of treasure it. Part time travel travelogue and part political sneer, Mondo Candido is a barrage of one bewildering set piece after another, a blending of sound and vision using Riz Ortolani's remarkable score to haul the viewer on many levels into Candido's bizarre story. It is shot with a professional eye for visual harmony, courtesy of cinematographer Giuseppe Rossellini, and sports some remarkable production values. Set designs, props, costume, and the sheer visual flair used to shape the numerous periods of time where the film takes place make for a hedonistic cocktail of cinematic eye candy, whilst the playfulness behind the message ensures Mondo Candido is as captivating as it is optically compelling. Prosperi wasn't as enthusiastic about the project as Jacopetti, but what they have produced, grudgingly in Prosperi's case, is exceptional. It's a really excellent piece of filmmaking. As always though, behind the scenes, trouble did flare up. It wouldn't be a Jacopetti or Prosperi picture if it didn't. For Mondo Candido, it was where the filmmakers didn't get the permission to film in New York City and had to flee the country before a court order could be made to arrest them. This really is the collaborator's swan song, as both went their separate ways to do other projects with only the underrated Animals Going Mad on PCP 1984 movie Wild Beasts, directed by Prosperi alone, which harkens back to the Mondo past. I actually enjoy these films, make no mistake about it. Despite the subject matter, the controversy and the unease, I can also see the beauty out of the barbaric through Prosperi and Jacopetti's lens, and feel that they should be praised more and not sidelined in a kind of guilt by cinematic association. These were not only fresh, exciting, and daring at the time, they still remain eyebrow-raising today, but now, some 50 and 40 years later, are now considered, in my opinion, my humblest opinion, perfect time capsules of a quirky, bygone age. Currently, Mondo Candido is only available on DVD, but I am hoping over time it will get a Blu-ray release, like all Jacopetti and Prosperi's cinematic legacy of Shocks and Hokum deserve. And with the Blu-ray format and that medium, it could bring a whole new dimension to the flora, fauna, and vista under scrutiny, underneath the misanthropic microscope. Right. We're at the end of Season 3, folks, and the last programme of Season 3 of Look, Look and Look Again. I'm going to have a bit of a break, but don't forget, you can still catch up with several editions of Look, Look and Look Again from my playlists, as well as I might be surprising you with a few one-offs to bridge that gap until our fourth season. Thank you so much for the subscriptions and the comments, they're delightful, and for helping me to shape the fourth season. You're all quite, quite wonderful. Until next time, from us all here at Look, Look and Look Again, cheerio. We'll be right back.
And the greatest love the world has known, this is the love I'll give to you alone. More than the simple words I try to say, I only live to love you more each day. More than you'll ever know, my arms long to hold you so. My life will be in your keeping, waking, sleeping, laughing, weeping, longer than always.
Yeah.